Today we continue in our expositional series of God is, the attributes and character of God, of the capital L, capital O, capital R, capital D, the tetragrammaton, Father God, Yahweh, Jehovah. Amen? Also known as Adonai, as we sung earlier. These are all based on the different characteristics of God these different names have. And if you came in really early today, Nancy was playing a CD on the names of God, which was really powerful. Maybe we'll do that to conclude the series. We'll play it during church. It's not that long. It's as long as you want it to be. But so today we arrive at part five of our series. And if I remember correctly, there's 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13. There's two more parts after today. All right? So it's going to be a seven-part series. And what a coincidence that the number seven, the number of divinity. And I didn't plan it that way. But today we're going to talk about God's attributes and characteristics of wisdom and his almightiness, that God is wise and God is almighty. Father God, I come before you today, Lord, and I thank you, Lord Jesus. I thank you, Lord, for your salvation, for your love for us. I thank you, Lord, for your righteousness and your judgments, Lord God. You know, think of it this way. His righteousness and his justice demand you get sent to hell. But it was because of that that he was able to exercise and manifest his compassion and his love, and he did it through a work of sending his son to die for you and for me. Amen? And Lord, for as much as it grieves me to think that Jesus had to do this for a wretch like me, that the perfect had to do this for the imperfect, that the godly had to do it for the ungodly, Lord, it's a painful thing, but I know that you said it was your pleasure to do it, and I know that Jesus said it was for his joy that he did it, Lord. So we thank you and we praise you, and we ask, Lord, that today we would bring all glory to you. Holy Spirit, that you would teach us through your word today. Use me, Lord. May my personality, may my charisma, may my talents not be what anyone sees today. May they see you. For you say, let them see Jesus. Amen. Well, once again, we're immersed in the scriptures regarding the character and attributes of the Lord. Capital L, capital O, capital R, capital D. Who, as Jesus teaches us in the Lord's Prayer, is our Father who art in heaven, right? Who is in heaven. So, the Father is in heaven, isn't he? And the Father is spirit. And yet, we just spoke last week about the Father being everywhere. How can that be? Well, if you look at Genesis 1, verse 1, you see that his spirit hovered over the deep. His spirit is everywhere. His spirit is God. It's the third person of the Trinity. Jesus is not everywhere. The person Jesus. Jesus is seated at the right hand of God. He is God in physical form. So that we have a, what do they call that? Like a contact point, a point of reference. If you want to see who the Father is, you need look no further than his son, Jesus. Amen? And together, this trinity of being, of persons, this one being, three persons, is in all things, is everywhere. It's not in all things, right? We don't worship trees and cars. We don't worship posters and flowers. We worship the being, God. We talked about that again last week. So once again, as we endeavor to plunge the depths of our God and who he really is, we come across attributes which one might, in a limited sense, attempt, if they're ignorant and prideful enough, to try and assign to themselves. Now, we couldn't do that with omnipresence, could we? That God is everywhere, right? Because we know we are finite beings enclosed in these flesh bodies, and we can only be one place at a time. So a person to say, well, I'm omnipresent, would be a person is insane. They are in need of counseling and care. But not so with these two attributes, wisdom and almighty. While most would not assign to themselves the idea of being almighty, many a wealthy and powerful business person would gladly and easily declare of themselves, how mighty I am, right? That's where you see this most plainly illustrated in the world today on TV, in media, is that these titans of capitalism, really, if you got to know them, they're narcissists, many of them. They're all about themselves, and they will claim how capable they are and how mighty they are to accomplish great deeds that have earned them much notoriety and wealth, right? You might even see this in the philanthropic sector of society, where somebody is so good, you know? And when I think of this, I'm thinking of one person in my mind immediately comes to mind, and they are both a titan in business and in philanthropy. Anyone want to guess who I'm talking about? Bill Gates. Who has taken it upon himself to be the savior of the world. You know, I don't know if you know, but, you know, obviously you know about Microsoft. He's Microsoft, right, Bill Gates? Yeah. You know about his success in the computer industry, but did you know that he has a foundation that he uses to solve all the problems of the world? All right? And, you know, I'm not going to begrudge him that, but did you also know he's buying up farmland in the United States? He's buying up all the farmland. No. Chinese are buying up all the businesses, right? They're trying to get in on real estate and things like that. But he's buying up all the farmland because he wants to control, for charitable sake, food supply. Now, that's really not a bad thing necessarily if that's truly why you're doing it. And maybe in his heart at this moment, that is why he's doing it. My fear that is that when you give a single person this much power, that it can corrupt you. And I think of the phrase when Jesus said, when he warned the church about the spirit of Antichrist, and this is 2,000 plus years ago, he warns about that, but then he says the spirit of Antichrist, that is already in the world. All right? So without further delay, let me begin with the next character and attribute on our list, that God is wise. The verse we're looking at closely today, considering this particular attribute, is to the Romans 16:27, to the only wise God be glory forevermore through Jesus Christ. Amen. All right, simple enough verse. I don't have to read that to you in the New Living Translation or the New International Version or the Simple Words Bible. There isn't one. I'm just making that up. But it's a salutation. It's a humble, submissive proclamation of who God is. And this happens to come at the ending of the book of Romans, which will be the next book I'm going to preach on expositionally after this series. The book of Romans is known as the Gospel to the Gentiles. That's its claim to fame. And the reason being is because it was written to the church in Rome, which at that time was the center of the Gentile world. It was the empire of the world at the time this was put together. All right? And it goes in depth into the gospel of grace, election, you know, the state of man, the state of the world. So it became known as the gospel to the Gentiles. And we're going to learn a lot from it. We're going to learn things that might offend you. It's just the way it is with the Word of God sometimes. It causes us to take a look at what we believe and where we're at. It'll obviously at times cause you to be very joyful and grateful. But, you know, the Word of God is challenging. He is doing a work in us, and he's using a chisel to do it. All right? He's not using a feather. Amen? God is wise. The wisdom of God. To the only wise God be glory forevermore. To the God be glory forevermore. To our God be glory forevermore. Is that what he's saying? No, it's not. To the only wise God be glory forevermore. Our Father in heaven is the only true God. That's the first lesson for today. There is no other. All other gods are figments of imagination. That's what it's called. The Bible uses the expression vain imaginations, empty imagination. All right? Because he is the only God, because he is a wise God, he deserves and he should be the object, the subject of all of our glory forevermore. Any goodness that we attribute in this life, and a Christian knows this, goes to God. That even if I, you know, I'll go back to Bill Gates. Even if Bill Gates were to feed 2 million people, if he was a believer, he would say, look, it's only because God gave me this gift and he's allowed me to do this, and I'm doing this in devotion to God, he'd be good to go, wouldn't he? But that's not what these people do. You see, the unsaved will do charitable works. But when they point to the source of that charitable work, they will point to their bank account, their talent, their wisdom, their accomplishments. And guess what? Doing philanthropic work, I can usually say this word, all right? But in doing this good work, it's still the spirit of Antichrist for just that reason. I was listening to a sermon this morning, and it's something worthy of preaching, talking about love and how in the Old Testament, God basically says, if you don't love me, you hate me. That's the standard he raises. So if you, and the context was, if you believe in God, the right God, yet you don't follow his rules, I guess you could say, what he likes, what he doesn't. Like, if you don't seek to do what he likes, but you acknowledge him as God, he still says, no, that's like hate. Because why? If you really loved me, why wouldn't you? It's like, and I use this analogy all the time. I go, I love my wife. If somebody handed me a book when I met Nancy, and it was the book of Nancy, and I read it, and I saw all the things, and I went, wow, man, I can learn, I can win her affection with this, I can please her with this, but I'm not going to. I love her, but I'm going to have an affair with this woman, and this woman, and this woman, and this woman. And on Friday night, instead of being with her, I'm going to be with her. Or I'm going to be fiddling with my car all the time, and Nancy gets my Saturday night, man, but Monday through Friday, 9 to 5, I'm on my cars. That's not being faithful. That's not being love, is it? And if she was sane, she would kick me to the curb. So words can be an empty thing, right? Anybody can say praise God. Anybody can say hallelujah. The question is, are you seeking to walk with the Lord? Obviously, you've got his grace if you're a believer. You know, none of us can claim we've perfectly attained to a perfect obedience in our lives. But what's the desire of your heart, of your soul, of your mind, of your strength? You want to be close to God. Well, here's how. Amen? This is where we all start. This is where we all continue. And this is where we all end. It shows us who he is. So disliking how I do to give you half a sentence, like I just did here, or even a verse without its surrounding context, let's take a look at Romans a little closer, starting at verse 25. This is the verse in its context, how the Apostle Paul ends off the book of Romans. Now to him, this is a 25 to 27. Now to him who is able to strengthen you according to my gospel and the preaching of Jesus Christ, according to the revelation of the mystery that was kept secret for long ages, but has now been disclosed and through the prophetic writings has been made known to all nations according to the command of the eternal God to bring about the obedience of faith. To the only wise God be glory forevermore through Jesus Christ. Amen. Now, here's the first thing I want to say, and that's this. I just read a lot to you. It's only three sentences. But it was 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 lines long. He said a lot there. You may be confused. So what do? I just go past it. No. You stop and you take a look at it word for word for word and until you get what he is saying. Because there is something there for each one of us. In every word that he is speaking, because who's he speaking for? He's speaking for Almighty God, who by the Spirit has inspired him to write these words. So we're going to do that right now. So there are several characteristics of God mentioned in these few verses. Several virtues which deserve recognition in their relationship to God's wisdom. So the first thing we have to do, because we're talking about this. This is the first word of our sermon today regarding his characteristics. What does it mean to be wise? What is wisdom? Webster's dictionary has two definitions for the word. And what was interesting about Webster with this particular word is that one definition ran into the other definition. And that's not normal for many words. But this word, you cannot do the second definition unless you can do the first one. Let's take a look. Slide number 5. The wisdom of God. Wisdom means properly having knowledge and seeing, right? You have knowledge, you're wise. If I learn the book, you might say I'm very wise in the Word of God. I come up here every Sunday, I preach to you, I do Bible study every Wednesday. I spend a good, 25 to 30 hours a week preparing sermons and Bible studies, right? I've been doing this for 17 years. So by that definition, I'm a wise man. See, I have a gray beard. Some cultures would automatically elevate me before this gray beard because it assumes you are wise, all right? But then there's a second definition, discreet and judicious in the use or applications of that knowledge. I can do all this. I can read, I can study, prepare these sermons, go out, and if I got a sugar on the side, am I being wise? Am I being an example of the wisdom of God? If I'm going out and I'm snorting cocaine on the side, you don't know until I get caught, because eventually the Lord will reveal my sin if I'm doing things like this. You see, when you gain knowledge, you also are vested by God, whether you want to admit it or not, with the responsibility of walking out that knowledge, of not being playing the part of, I wish I had a mask, put a mask in front of me, the hypocrite, of wearing a false face. That's what actors did in the medieval age. Is when they were on stage, they had a mask on for the character they're playing. And then when they were done, they would take that mask away. May I never be like that. And that's why I really try to be as transparent as I can. And some use that against me. But you need to know I'm not a perfect man. And none of you are. So as I give you grace, as the Lord gives you grace, I expect and I hope for grace from you in those moments when I may not be acting so godly. Like, I'll give you an example. You should have been here at 9 o'clock today for worship rehearsal. Now, nothing bad happened, but, you know, I was getting tense, man. Everything was going wrong. Everybody needed batteries. Sound system wasn't working, you know? But I can do all things through Christ Jesus, right? I got to just calm down and it all gets resolved, and it all got resolved. It's the funny thing about everything we go through. You know, we get worked up. That's our immediate impulse. You know, it's like a hurricane that's traveling at 3,000 miles per hour. The bad thing happens, and it's like, and you're reacting. The storm's there. And you got to just chill, exactly, and let a little bit of time go by, because it's going 3,000 miles an hour. It's going to go and disappear eventually. Your life is going to be a season of trials and pleasures and joys and pains, and you know what I mean? That's the human condition. It's not something reserved for just Christians. What God does with those things is reserved for Christians as something good, something that he uses to conform you into his image. So properly having knowledge is the first definition. Having the power of discerning and judging correctly, or of discriminating between what is true and what is false, what is fit and what is proper, what is good to do, what is bad to do, what is compassionate and what is selfish. And then it says, as a wise prince or a wise official. King Solomon was deemed the wisest man, right? I don't know if you know this. David's son Solomon became king of Israel, and God was with him. And God came to him one night, and he said, ask me whatever you want, and I will give it to you. And now, you know, King Solomon's, he's a king. He's in a dynasty, right? And so if he was a depraved man, what he would say is, I want more riches. I want you to expand the kingdom. I want you to give us prosperity and health and wealth. Amen. What does he ask for? Lord, this is exactly what he says. Lord, please grant me wisdom that I might judge this people rightly and lead them. And you know what God said? He said, you know what? He goes, that was a good prayer. And because that's your heart, I'm going to give you power and riches. And he became one of the richest kings ever, and it corrupted him. Now, he repented at the end of his life, but that's a different story. So King Solomon was a man who was speculatively wise. In other words, you could look at him and go, I think he's wise. He knows a lot. I'm speculating that he is a wise man. But then if I watch him progress through life, I would go, practically, not very wise. He started off well, but he went off the rails. And he knew better. He was a believer. It's a picture for us to be very cautious of where we go in life, all right? So in other words, a man can be smart in the head and dumb in how they use their knowledge. Hence, the second definition, discreet and judicious. What does that mean, Pastor? It means able to reason both morally and fairly in the use or application of knowledge. Choosing praiseworthy and commendable acts that bring about praiseworthy and commendable results, and the best ways and actions to obtain them. This is what it means to be practically wise. All right, so now going back to our verses, Paul informs us that God is capable of providing us with strength through the heeding of the words of Paul and of Christ. That's the summary of those three verses I read to you. And then it ends off with his, because he is capable of doing this and has provided these things for us, glory be to God, the only wise God. And that's how he ends it. In other words, by heeding the words of this book, giving us his word, if we choose to live lives of obedience, we will be strengthened for whatever trials come our way in the course of our lives. in the course of lives lived for Christ and of the gospel. And look, I know you're not perfect. I know you're going to make your mistakes. Look, you may be at parts of the Bible when you read it. You may not even be in agreement. Because he hasn't done that work in you where he reveals to you that, look, you know, this is what I'm saying. And I know you don't agree with it. But brother, sister, it's time to let go and say, I am God to me. And subject yourself to me in this area. You got to trust me. Right? Did you ever see the meme on Facebook where the little girl, she lost her, Jesus takes away her doll. It's about this big. And she's crying, and yet behind his back, he's holding a doll that's this big. We all have idols in our lives, and they're not all statues. Some of them are beliefs. And the way you know it's an idol is that when it comes up against God and his word, there's a conflict. There's a test of loyalty that takes place. You have to choose, because they're in opposition, who you will serve. The plan of God and his dictates as received, right? That's the word of God, are the manifestation of his wisdom. Look, you have a book. It's manifested. It's a book. It's solid. It's got pages. God saw to it to make sure that we had a record of who he is. That's what the Bible is. It's a record of who he is. And it's shown many times through the lens of people. The Jewish people, the Gentile people, right? I'll give you an example. God showed himself as righteous through the Israelites when they rejected God at the base of Mount Sinai, right? He showed himself as compassionate through Moses, who delivered Israel out of Egypt. And we're going to be talking about Egypt through somebody who came before Moses, Joseph, in just a few minutes. God showed himself as just in the New Testament when he caused Herod's, he proclaimed himself God. And God made him fall down and burst, his bowels burst open. He got an illness, like a disease. Because he dared to put himself in the place of God. He showed himself as just through Ananias and Sapphira in Acts chapter 5. You see, the God who's just in the Old Testament through judgment is the same God who's just in the New Testament through judgment. He shows him as merciful, as himself as merciful and compassionate through Christ and what he did, showing us that we don't have to go the way of the dodo and go to hell, that we can be restored to him, that it's a free gift. And he shows us all this through this record of his for us. This isn't dead literature. This isn't legalism, this book. It's how you do this book that determines if you're going to be legalistic or compassionate. If you're going to be legalistic or of grace. Grace doesn't cause you to have to throw justice out the window. Grace shows us when to be merciful and when to be just. And what's the hinge? Anyone? Repentance. Belief. So this book is the manifestation of his wisdom, his knowledge of how we can be saved and how we can live rightly, and his amazing moral and just way of dealing with sinners as well as with the repentant believer. And what are these ways in which he deals with us? Through the lens of grace, right? With compassion, forbearance, patience, forgiveness towards believers. Or through the lens of law, righteousness, justice, judgment, condemnation towards those who never do come to faith in Christ, unbelievers. That's the way it is. That's his word. That's his plan. He ordained it. It's perfect. So if we butt up against that and go, well, I don't necessarily, well, your problem is with God. And there's a real situation there that we have to reflect on, isn't there? Paul clearly intends to stimulate the Roman Christians' praise of God by reminding them of what he has told them of God's wonderful plan for their salvation in Jesus Christ. No less purpose do I stand before you now, with no less purpose, preaching to you, to declare to you the wisdom of God, his plan of salvation, that there is a condemnation, but there is a salvation. To stimulate your praise of God by reminding you that God decided in his wisdom to save a group of people of which he deemed you, I hope, would be a part. Romans 16:27 once again says, to the only wise God be glory forevermore through Jesus Christ. Amen. There is absolutely no other wise plan in this world which can accomplish what God has, is, and will be accomplishing right up to the day of Christ's second coming. It's called in Greek the parousia. The salvation of undeserving souls to and for his glory. Amen? If we look now at the story of Joseph in the Old Testament, for example, we see the wisdom of God through Joseph's being. Now, this is all from, I think it's like 45 to 52. Focuses a lot on chapter 50 in Genesis. This is the whole Joseph narrative, which in Bible study we're quickly approaching, which will be an amazing in-depth study in a new covenant way, how it applies to us, what he is teaching us through Joseph to us. All right, so through Joseph, God's wisdom is displayed in Joseph's being first left for dead in a pit by his own brothers. That was God's wisdom. Being sold into slavery by the same brothers, God's wisdom. Rising in his slavery in Egypt to become head of Potiphar's household. Potiphar worked directly for Pharaoh. All right, so he's working for a man of influence one step below Pharaoh now. God's wisdom. Having Potiphar's wife attempt to get Joseph to commit sexual adultery with her, and upon failing, accusing Joseph of rape. And from that false charge, Joseph is sent to prison, where after somewhere between 8 to 12 years in the clink, Joseph interprets the dreams of the royal cupbearer and royal baker to Pharaoh. This is all God's wisdom, by the way. And then they end up betraying him. They ended up in a jail cell with him. He interpreted dreams. The cupbearer was going to be restored. The baker was going to have his head chopped off. Both happened. Cupbearer was restored back to being the cupbearer of Pharaoh. He was in the presence of Pharaoh. Joseph says, just please do me a favor. I've been here 8 to 12 years. I'm paraphrasing. Please, when you go back to Pharaoh, tell him about me. See if maybe you can get me some mercy. And the cupbearer went back and nothing. That was God's wisdom. Now, you may be wondering how this is good. No less than in your own life. When you're going through one thing after another thing after another thing, I guarantee you it wasn't as bad as what happened to this man, Joseph. And yet it's all part of God's plan. How, Pastor? Let me continue. At a later date, the same cupbearer, restored to position as Pharaoh's man, recommends Joseph to Pharaoh to interpret a disturbing dream Pharaoh had, giving Joseph the opportunity to, point number 9, interpret the dream correctly and advise Pharaoh regarding a coming famine. And 10, ultimately, it gets Joseph installed as prime minister over all of Egypt. This Jew, who was in prison, accused of rape, becomes prime minister of Egypt. A position where Joseph is able to save not only the people of Egypt, but all of Israel from death by starvation. It is in this role that Joseph stands as an illustration of God's wisdom, as well as being himself a picture of the Christ, he who saves souls. Jew and Gentile alike, right? Jew and Egyptian, from famine. That's what that's the picture of. From the eternal death of hellfire. See the wisdom of God. How he applied his wisdom to all of Joseph's circumstances to bring glory to his name and for Joseph's good, and that Joseph could faithfully and confidently declare to his brothers, who started this process by throwing him in a pit and leaving him for dead. You know, that was a necessary step. The rape accusation, that was necessary. He ended up in jail because of that. The cupbearer found out who he was and that he was empowered by God. God used that to get him into Pharaoh's presence. God used that to elevate him to prime minister, so that at a later date, during the famine, Joseph invites all of Israel to Egypt. He reveals himself to his brothers. They're all scared because when they find out, they're thinking that he's telling us that's him, because they didn't recognize him. And they expected he would do retribution, vengeance. So they were fearing, and this is what he says to them right here. Genesis 50, verses 19 and 20. This is the compassion of Christ. This is the compassion that you're called to and you're called to for those who have wronged you. Do not fear, for am I in the place of God? In other words, God says, vengeance is mine. He instructs us not to exact vengeance on people. Am I in the place of God? As for you, you meant evil against me, but God meant it for good, to bring it about that many people should be kept alive as they are today. Joseph was able to see. How many of you can say hindsight's 20/20? Right? Joseph was able to look back as the prime minister and go, you know, if Potiphar's wife didn't do that to me, I wouldn't be here now. If I didn't spend those 8 to 12 years in prison, I wouldn't be here now. Joseph had every reason to be bitter. Surely he was railroaded. And just as surely he was treated unfairly from everyone along the way. Even Pharaoh's cupbearer treated him unfairly upon his release and restoration back to his job with Pharaoh. It was only a year or two later, when Pharaoh had a bad dream that he was troubled over, and the cupbearer went, oh, I remember Joseph. And he said, I know this guy who can interpret this. And he's like, well, get him. Where is he? He's like, he's in prison. And that's how Joseph got out. Through this all, Joseph could have responded in anger and bitterness. You know anyone who's been through stuff like that? Who have become angry and bitter? I do. It's like, you know, you listen and it's literally like this poison coming out of their mouth. I always picture it like a viper shooting venom when they talk. It's talking about other people, with how they've been wronged. You know, just it's really sad. And you try to tell them, look, don't you see that the only person you're poisoning with this venom is yourself? Can't you see that? You've got to let it go. You have to let it go. I don't think I've mastered this. There are people in my life that I don't hate anybody. I don't forward that I resent them and I'm bitter towards them and I wish them the worst. I don't do that for anybody. But there are still people I'm feeling hurt about what's been done to me. I pray for them. I ask the Lord to bless them. I also ask the Lord to save them if they're not. And I ask the Lord to give me a heart of forgiveness and love towards them. And then I say, Lord, I release them from anything they did to me. And I pray that you'll release me, because they're mad at me for something. I might have some guilt. And then I hope and I pray and I trust that with time, that will become a complete thing in my forgiveness for them. Amen? I think I'm just going to preach on this one attribute today, because I'm getting more than what's in the sermon, and I don't want to keep us for an hour and a half. And We're at about 40 minutes now. So through this all, Joseph remained faithful to God. I call that a miracle. I don't know about you. Right? But God did it. I mean, I think about my life and the abuse that I've gone through from different people. And it doesn't even compare to what this guy went through. And I struggle with it. Right? And I'm like, if I'm struggling with what I went through, this guy, I mean, how does he? It's the power of God. Only the power of God can transform your heart. And I wish I could tell you that when you get saved, all these things just magically appear. You know what that would be called if that happened? That would be called immediate total sanctification. You'd be made holy like that. Now, in your spirit, Bible tells us that our spirits are seated in heavenly places with Christ Jesus. I got good news for you. Your spirit is perfect. It's holy. It's without sin. But your mind and your heart, well, that's got to go through a purification process. And that, in the theology, is called progressive sanctification. So you have immediate sanctification, and you have progressive sanctification. Immediate, that's done. When you came to faith in Christ, done. Progressive sanctification is that struggle we go through day by day, the burden that is called life, where it hurts. Doesn't always hurt. You go through good times too, right? You can say as a believer, as a human being, you have gone through good times. But hey, you go through your struggles. I go through my struggles. And that is, think of Michelangelo. I think that was the one who did all the statues. Chisel, nice sharp chisel, hammer. Well, the Bible calls it in the Old Testament, it equates to fuller's soap. It's the soap that the dry cleaner would use. Right? It's a bar of soap that is acidic. It's an acid soap. So that as, and it's rough, so it scrubs you with acid. That's what sanctification feels like. Can I hear an amen? Because that is exactly what sanctification feels like, right? And then we're trying to, in the midst of all this, keep our cool. We're trying not to blow up. We're trying not to lose our temper. We're trying not to curse. We're trying not to become bitter. We're trying not to be resentful. We're trying not to have vengeance. And you see, that's where you gauge yourself. Are you getting better with that? Is the Lord doing a work in you? All right? And like Nancy told me last night, I forget what she told me last night. I had it and then I lost it. But anyway, the point being that I am better than I was. I am not the man she married 27 years ago. That's how long it's been. She's not the woman I married. Thank goodness. No, I'm kidding. But you get the point, right? He will not leave you or forsake you. And how perfect you are and how imperfect you are has zero bearing on your sanctified spirit that's already seated in heavenly places with Christ Jesus. So that's good news. That should allow you to rest. You see, he says his burden is light. What it shouldn't do is go, well, thank God, I don't have to stop smoking crack. Because, hey, my spirit's already seated. My smoking crack is actually going to let people see how great the grace of God is because I'm still saved. That is a logic that Paul intentionally brings up in the book of Romans to tell us that if you're thinking that way, you're not saved because we are all called to fight the good fight of faith. We have been given new hearts with new desires that we should want to live for God. This way, when you struggle, you're going to be showing remorse and you're going to want to repent. And you're going to go before the throne of grace. See, people who aren't repenting don't go through any of these things. They just sin. Romans 8:28. And we know that for those who love God, all things work together for good, for those who are called according to his purpose. We know, you, brother and sister, friend, if you're a believer in Jesus Christ, I want you to be saved if you're just my friend and you're not my brother and sister. You need to repent and believe. You need to turn to God, turn to Christ, put aside those things as you pick up the Bible and learn it that are not of God and walk closer and closer and closer to him in who you are and in who he is every day. You will make your mistakes. You will take backward steps. You can then go to the throne of grace and say, Lord, right? But we can know as believers that for those who love God, because a believer loves God, right? I started the sermon out this way. And love means wanting to read the book of God. This is God. Oh, I love him. I want to read this. I want to do what pleases him. I want to bring a smile to his face. I love God. All things work together for good for those who are called according to his purpose. And that's in the framework of salvation. That's the purpose. For those who are called according to his purpose to save some. He purposed in your heart, Marlene, that you would be one of the girls, women he saved. You would be his daughter. God in his wisdom will also use all of your trials, all of your pain, all of your suffering. Well, for what? Verse 29. For those whom he foreknew, he also predestined. And here's the for what. Here's why you suffer. To be conformed to the image of his son. None of us, Bible says, have suffered unto blood. In other words, he's the only one that hung on a cross for anybody. His suffering had to be worse than anything we would ever go through. And the Bible tells us that Christ learned obedience through his suffering. You see, because he was a young man. He was a baby. He had to grow. The man, Jesus, the human Jesus, not the God Jesus, Son of God, the Son of Man, had to learn obedience. No less than we have to learn obedience. And if he did it through suffering, so will we. For those whom he foreknew, he knew you before the beginning of time. He also predestined. He mapped out your path from the beginning of time. You were predestined to something. Now, the word predestined speaks of destination. You are predestined to arrive, brother and sister, at salvation. Into the family of God. You were predestined for adoption. At the beginning of time, he went, I am going to adopt Pearl. Now, Pearl, at 30 years old, and I don't know anything about Pearl's life walk like this, but she might have been somebody that somebody would look at and go, no way, is that person ever going to heaven? And yet, here she sits. It could happen when you're 10. It could happen when you're 30. It could happen when you're 50. It could happen as you take your last breath. Amen? Because he foreknew you and he predestined you to be conformed to the image of his son. Why? Well, in order that he might be firstborn among many brothers. That's again speaking twofold. Son of man, he is the firstborn. If you come to our Bible study, you would know about primogenitor. He is not the firstborn again man. Jesus Christ did not need to be born again. He's been God for all of eternity. So anyone who tells you he's the firstborn again man, they're lying. They're in error. It's false doctrine. God is God. He never stopped being God. All right? In his humanity and in his spirit, as the heir of all the promises, God adopted brothers and sisters who were not the firstborn. And that's us. What love. What wisdom. I want to close out here just once again reminding you about Joseph. And I really want to encourage you like I did last week, not because I want more numbers in Bible study, because I want you to start wanting to learn this by coming to prayer, by coming to Bible study, being a part of what we're doing together as a body. All right? Joseph's brothers, they couldn't stand him. And I got to tell you, because, you know, he was the kind of guy, I don't know if this is to his credit, but he would have these dreams about how, you know, he was going to be over everybody. And he would go, hey, guys, I had another dream last night that I'm going to be over you. That's the kind of thing he did. And then his father makes him a coat of many colors. It's just, this is my boy, Joseph. And they had it. They were in their flesh. That was the spirit of Antichrist working through them. They had it. They threw him in a pit and left him for dead. They were hoping a lion would come along and fall in the pit. That's what they were hoping for. They come back to check on him. It's like, he's still alive. Well, here comes a band of traitors. Traitors, they sell things. Sell and buy. Traitor, not traitors. Like, okay. And they're like, hey, you want a slave? And they went and they pulled Joseph out and they sold him. Now, these traders were from Egypt. They go down to Egypt and they put Joseph on the slave market. Potiphar comes along. He buys him. Potiphar was the head of the house of Pharaoh. In other words, he took care of all the affairs in the palace. Or was he head of security? I don't remember. But anyway, so now he's working. He was the head of Potiphar's household. And he's working there. And he's got a hot wife. And he's a handsome man. And Potiphar, he's gone a lot because he works for Pharaoh. And she's like, hey, Joseph. And Joseph's like, look, you're a really nice person. You know, he probably shared his faith with her. I mean, who knows? He didn't give in. And then she got so bad that one day she literally grabbed him to, like, make out with him, to start something. And he pulled away, and she was holding on so tight that when he pulled away, his coat came off, and he fled. And then she goes to her husband, how dare he do this to me? And she goes to her husband with this coat. She goes, this is what happened. He tried to rape me, and I pulled this coat off him, and he ran away because he heard you coming. 12 years in prison. Lied to by the cupbearer. Oh, I'll tell Pharaoh about you. Another year or two goes by. Brothers and sisters, this is a picture of what we go through in our lives. This is a picture, first and foremost, of what Christ had to go through to become, to arrive at his destination as redeemer, sacrifice, atoner, on the cross through a painful, horrible death for your sake. Through a painful, horrible death, Joseph was raised up. Just as Christ is raised up, Christ was given the crown when he got to heaven. God gave him the name above all names. He gave him the keys to the kingdom. He was rewarded for what he did when he arrived back at the Father. The Father said to Jesus, I'm stepping aside. I'm still here, but you are now over everything. That's what's happening right now. Father God's still there, and Jesus still, he's still above God. The Father's still above the Son. See, that's another doctrine you might hear, that he's the name above all names, even Yahweh. That's a lie, false doctrine. Because it says that at the end of time, Jesus will present the keys back to the Father. We all throw our crowns down at his feet. And then Jesus does the same to the Father. And he says, it is all yours, Lord. Just as Jesus had to go through it, just as Joseph had to go through it, we all go through it. But trust God. Trust him. He's doing a process in you. He is purging you. He's chiseling you. He's adding things in. and he's making something beautiful. Amen? Just don't give up. Persevere. In the name of Jesus. Amen. Father, I thank you, Lord, for this time. And I only preached half a sermon today, but I think that's all that was meant to be preached, Lord. Now it's going to be 8 parts. Sorry. But, Lord, I am just so thankful that that's who you are. That in your wisdom, you're the one who made up the rules. You're the one who said, you know, you're the one who said, be ye perfect as I am perfect. Right? And that's like, oh, wait. And then you're the one that said, I'm the author and finisher of that faith. And then you're the one who said, and I won't let anyone pull you out of my hands. Thank you, Lord, for your faithfulness. You alone are worthy. You are the wise God. Amen.